Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to episode number 155 here on season number 2. And today we are getting to three things I wish people would have told me before I started to trade, or three things I wish I knew before trading. These videos are meant for educational purposes only and not meant to be taken as financial advice. You are responsible for your assets and to properly protect them. So always please do your own research. Number one is that there are a lot of people out there that know a heck of a lot more than you do or I do. And I sit back and every single time I hear myself say this, I kind of like irk, and I'm like, how come I didn't think about this before? Like, how come I didn't apply that rule to trading? And for me, I think it seemed like I would be different. Like the people that I watched on YouTube, the videos I watched, the books that I watched, I kind of was like, you know what? I understand it. Like, I understand how these people are making it, and like, I can take what they do and apply it to the market and be pretty successful at it. Like, I'm confident that I'll be able to beat people and be able to do a lot better than people think that I could do. Which, that's not to say that I like absolutely fail. I mean, I think for me it was a good learning experience on how the stock market works, and so I don't consider it a total fail. I just consider it like, I'm glad that I learned my lesson early on, and so I didn't have to like lose almost my entire account. I only lost a little bit of it, you know what I mean? For me, I found myself, I guess, more or less looking for confirmation bias. I would look to people's videos who were like getting those big, huge wins, and it was kind of like one of those cycles that it was like really addicting. Like, I was like, oh my goodness, like that guy got a big win. Like, oh my goodness, that person got a big win. And it was like, if somebody was saying like, you shouldn't day trade on YouTube or in real life, I was like, and whatever, you guys don't know what you're talking about. Like, I see these people do it every single day. Like, it's so exciting, it's so awesome. Now looking back, I'm like, that's great, but everybody can't do that. You know what I'm saying? For me, it's one of those things that I look back and I'm like, I probably, like as of right now, I probably could still, you know, trade and become really successful at it. But for me, I think logically looking at it is like, it's not the best idea for me to trade, considering that I've had better returns long-term investing. So right now I need to focus on long-term investing because it makes more logical sense to focus on that instead of becoming a trader via swing trading or day trading. Thinking about it, I should have realized like there are a lot of big companies out there and people in general that have been trading the markets for a very long time that have tons of experience with how the markets react and how the ebb and flow kind of goes. The data that they have, the odds, the statistical analysis, the supercomputers, and so much more that they have. I mean, the odds are practically stacked against me. And for some reason, I guess my confirmation bias never like took this into consideration. It was like, just ignore that. You'll be better than that. Anyways, let's go ahead and jump into number two, which is the highs come with the lows. I specifically remember winning my first trade, and I know you guys are like, kind of, this is weird, but like for me, it was a big deal. It was a stock listed MGT. It was kind of like this crazy thing that happened. Basically, John McAfee, who you know started McAfee Antivirus, became the CEO of this company called MGT. At the time when that was announced, the stock was, I think, like 50 cents or something like that. Well, the first day it popped from about 50 cents all the way up to like 250. And I didn't pull the trigger and get into the trade then. However, I waited, and the next day I was at the gym working out. I think I was like on the bench press or something like that. I remember like thinking like, you know what, this drops back down to $2. I'm gonna go ahead and pick up some shares. And so it dropped back down to $2, picked up some shares. And then, you know, about 30 minutes, 40 minutes later, it was like 250 again. And I was like, selling, boom. So I closed my position on that and walked away, I think like with like $10 or something like that. However, the next 2 to 3 days, when it ran all the way up to $5, I kept on kicking myself in the rear end because I was like, I could have had way more profit if I would have known what I was doing, and like I should have just stayed in longer. Like, why didn't I stay in longer? But then also I remember my number one loss, not as clearly, because I don't know why. Maybe that's just the way that our brains works. We kind of like forget that stuff, try to forget the bad and only remember, you know, the exciting good stuff. And it was a stock that I think jumped up to like 80 cents that day. And I was like, great, I'll pull the trigger. I want to pull back. And so it pulled back and I bought it around 80 cents. Well, it dropped down to around like 70 cents, 65 cents in about the matter of like 2 hours. And I was like, oh my goodness, like, what should I do? Like, do I close my position? I don't know. Like, dude, I have a stop loss set. Like, what's my stop loss? All this kind of stuff. And I honestly didn't know how to approach this because I didn't have a plan when I went into it. Like, I completely made a mistake. And so from there, I was like, all right, like, I'm just going to turn off the noise, get off my phone, like, not worry about it. Get off the screens, not worry about this, drown out the noise. Like, I'll just come back and check at the end of the market. And at the end of the market, it was floating around the same thing. Like, I would say like $65.70 stock. So I had already lost about, you know, 10 to 15 cents. And I was like, all right, I'll just hold until tomorrow. I held till tomorrow and I was like, I'll hold till tomorrow. It'll gap up and then I'll just go ahead and close. Hopefully break even or heck, even turn a profit, right? Well, I wake up in the morning, it gaps down to 55 cents. And I was like, you know what? Forget this. I'm out. Clear my losses. Walked away negative $15. Like, I was like, oh my goodness, I'm so glad to be out of this, right? But like, this experience was something that I had honestly never felt before for me. Like, I wanted to get back into the trade and take my profits back, you know, or to recoup my losses basically, or like, heck, even go ahead and make more of these trades to try to, you know, get back some of my profit. But then like, pair that with like, but what happens if I lose again? And like, then I'm like, how could I tell anybody about the loss? Like, I basically failed, you know what I mean? And I think this was because all I seen on YouTube and in Reddit books was about people winning. Like, this is the winning setup. This is the winning setup. This is the winning setup. Like, you'll basically never lose with this setup. And it's like, that's not true. Like, there are losses and they are real and they feel like this, but nobody's really talking about them. And so all I thought was like, the greats, the high highs are great, but like the lows, they come and go, you know what I mean? Like, they don't worry about them. And lastly, number three, the quicker the money, the more risky the business. Me personally, like, I understood what risk meant, you know what I mean? But I never understood what it meant, I guess, in regards to trading, maybe slash investing. For me, I never really saw the vice versa effect of exponential growth, that you could pair that with exponential risk. And that would be basically the kind of swing and how things would go. Like, I understand a compound interest and kind of how that works. Like, you know, $1 turns into $2, which turns into $4, which turns into $8, which turns into $16, which turns into $32 and $64 and $128 and so on and so forth until basically the chart starts to go like this and you're like just climbing at a crazy rate. Where before it took a while, you know, it takes a little while to take off, but once you start taking off, like, you're gone. You know what I mean? I didn't realize that worked the opposite way, that exponential growth worked the other way. And like I just said, like, I can see now the compound interest applied to the other side of the equation. To kind of explain this, I see Apple stock, you know, it's pretty low risk, but also it's not going to get you like a huge roar. Like, you might get like 10, 20% maybe the next year, but it's not going to be like this huge risk stock. But then you got like a 20 cents penny stock, you know, higher risk, higher reward. But I would have placed this risk like not super risky. Like, I would have probably placed it like a little bit below Apple. So say Apple was here and this was kind of like the chart diagonally, I would have put it right, like right here. Like, it wasn't really much of a difference. You know what I mean? Like, I'm like, yeah, it's way more risky, but like, it's not that much risk. You know what I'm saying? No, I should have been completely wrong. Like, basically I would have considered it a not super risky investment, but a super big reward. And basically, like I was saying, that wouldn't have been into the proportion of exponential decrease on the risk versus reward for that stock. However, if you take something like cryptocurrency, Bitcoin, huge growth potential, crazy, and I mean absolute crazy risk, like that to me, like when I see that, like I'm like, okay, the huge swings, like I totally get that, like going from $20,000 down to $10,000 in the matter of like 3 to 4 months, like that's just completely crazy. I think about that and I'm like, now I finally get the risk reward exponential growth, how that happens, but also the exponential decrease that happens on the other side if it's not a winning trade or a winning investing stock. Anyways, that wraps it up. These are, again, the top three things I wish I knew before I went into trading. If you prefer these videos where I kind of more or less open up and share my experience and share my story, feel free to let me know down in the comments. If you guys had any like fourth or fifth thing that you wish someone would have told me, I would love to see that in the live stream or also down in the comments as well. Feel free to let me know your thoughts and opinions. But let's leave it right there. Let's jump into the question of the day, which is, do you eat food that's past its expiration date if it smells good and looks fine? And the answer is yes, to some degree. I mean, if I look at the expiration date first, then I won't eat it probably, you know what I mean? However, if I don't look at the expiration date and it smells good and tastes good and that's all I'm basing upon, then I'll probably eat it, because what do I got to, I didn't ever see the expiration date, so I'm not like held accountable to that. But if I see the expiration date, then I probably will not touch it. But if someone sneaks it in, then I I mean, hey, if you're going to be sneaky like that, by all means, be sneaky. You know what I'm saying? Anyways, like I always say, if you got a question regarding Stash, Acorns, Robinhood, M1 Finance, as well as general investing, business, Etsy coaching, post those questions down below. Please don't forget to subscribe right up here and check out my M1 account has now been funded. Check out this video right here. And as always, thank you for watching. I really appreciate it.